It's 12 o'clock on a Wednesday. I'm Dave.
I'm Craig.
And this is the Wizard Product Review on this week's show.
On this week's show, we've got the latest effect by the master, Shim Lim.
Who brought us Think.
And we met him at the international convention over the weekend.
Nice guy. He's
a very nice guy. And superbly, unbelievably talented with a deck of cards.
He doesn't know a thing or two about card magic.
What this kid can't do with cards doesn't need to be...
Which wasn't apparent on Think, because it was kind of like hands off. You don't do anything.
Exactly.
He could have phoned in his performance.
He really could have, but this is more of the style of magic that he's known for. It's not a setup deck, a pre-setup deck, nothing like that. It is instead a technique. And you described it better. How did you describe it?
Like a card sword.
Yeah, it's like
a card sword for close-up.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly how it is.
But with no sword.
Yeah. But other than that, the analogy stands, yeah. You get a pack of cards. You get a card picked. You get a card selected. It's lost in the deck. You spring the cards into the air, and you reach into the spring as the cards are in the air, and you pull out a selected card. That's basically the shinag... I don't know how
you feel funny saying it.
Yeah, the shinag control.
Schnag.
It's the shag. It's the shag.
Come on. Shag control or whatever, I don't know.
It's the shag thing. And that's what happened. Now, there's many, many variations.
Oh, my God.
Many. In fact...
Too many.
Yeah. I've never said this in a DVD before, but I actually turned around to Dave and I said, please, Dave, make it stop. I want it to end.
Because he goes through the catching. He goes through catching it between two other cards.
I mean, he explains it brilliantly.
Catching four of a kind.
Yeah, changing one card
into
the other.
And you'd be the first to start moan. Come on, you'd be the first to moan if he said he didn't cover it enough.
Yeah, you know why? You know. And his explanations are brilliant. He uses an Omni deck and a memento gimmick to actually explain the move.
The controls
just a wonderful
and that kind
idea.
Of thing, yeah.
And there's so many variations. You can change a card from one into another. You can catch a card in between two other cards. There's many variations, but the problem with it is, in my mind, the actual schnag methodology involves you springing the cards.
He's been practicing saying it for 10 minutes before the show.
schnag. It means that you're going to spring the cards all over the floor.
Yeah, that's the problem. If you're out there working in the real world, you know, drinks receptions disrupt.
Yeah. Seriously.
You got the card in your hand, but immediately people sort of look down. Then you've got this very awkward moment.
Yeah.
I'm sure, like, Shinny's got his brother that does all his filming and that. He probably just employs his brother to go around with a dustpan and brush, follow him around. And if you're in a close-up competition, that doesn't matter, because that's your finale. You know?
Exactly. And it would make a great finale to a card act. You know, you're doing a card routine and you finish off by producing the card out of a spring. It's brilliant. But I sat here, and maybe you guys can help me, I couldn't think of many places you could use this. You can't use it walk around. You can't use it reception. You can't do it restaurants. You can't
what
do it
I
big
thought
tables.
Was
you
if
can't
it
do
sprung
it
into something.
Yeah.
Because the spring kind of goes past and you catch that cup. Maybe you could have a container there.
That's
or
a great idea. You walk
I don't
around.
Know.
So you in
take
my next
a
restaurant.
Bin.
In my next restaurant, Greg, I come out with a dustbin. Just let me stick that there for the finale of my act. Thank you very much. And then just pick them up out of the dustbin.
I think it's got merit.
Really?
I think we should email him. And,
yeah,
like,
and suggest to him the dustbin.
Suggest, because what it needs is another variation at
it
the
just
end.
Needs, that's what this DVD
another
needs.
Another dustbin variation. Well, we both agree that it looks good.
We should comment, although we're talking about the cards being sprung everywhere, that he does have a variation where he dribbles them onto a table and reaches into the dribble and pulls out the selected card. Now, obviously, that would mean that the cards wouldn't end up all over the floor. The problem with it is the dribble method doesn't look anywhere near as good as the schnag springing thing. You know, it looks so much better when he just reaches into the spring.
It does look good.
I said to
it's
you,
where you're going to use it.
If I was doing a parlor show,
yep.
And I was doing a multiple card finder routine, which I do.
Yeah.
And I think this would be a fantastic
Would you
ending.
Honestly do it? Multiple card find finale, would you?
I think it would work really well, but no, I wouldn't want to pick the cards up even in a parlor show. It might look really good in a video promo.
It would look good in a show.
But are you going to learn the technique?
I think it would be good in a show reel, because that's the thing. When you see it on the trailer and it's cropped like that, you don't see the cards. You just see that card and that's the focus. Nothing else takes
but
the focus
But to be honest,
away
if you're doing it
me,
in
I
a video promo,
good.
You can just reach in and grab any card. It doesn't matter whether it's a selected card or not. You can just try and reach and grab any one.
Yeah, if you're just having like a little sort of... soundbite type thing, montage. Yeah, I need a montage. What a great movie that is. How much are you going to give it?
What's sad is I know what movie you're talking about as well. What am I going to give it? I'm going to... You know what? I'm a big fan of Shin. I think he's very, very good. Unfortunately, I can't give this more than 75%. It's a valid...
The technique's good.
It's a valid technique. It should be published because people out there... It's different.
And if you've got a use for it, you probably give it 95% or more.
But I don't have a use for it, and I can't think of many places where I could or anybody could use it. That's why it's only getting 75%.
Same here. And I'll give it 72%. And if I was going to do a close-up card sword style thing, I'd probably go for the Cornelius method instead.
Now, one of my favourite magicians of all time in the whole history of magic is the one and only... Not you.
Well, I know that's not true. Right.
No. It's the... I love you, man. No, it's Greg Wilson. Greg Wilson is absolutely fantastic. And you summed it up brilliantly.
John's struggling getting it off the stick.
He knows that we're about to, and he's getting ready. If you just saw that jolt. Greg is a wonderful performer.
He's a fantastic performer.
Which is why when you
he
get
knows
one
his
of...
Stuff.
Yeah.
I've nicked all his lines.
Yeah, yeah, I've nicked most of them as well. Only the funny lines, not the stuff. And because this is a non-card DVD, you don't see him...
Yeah, he's not doing that. I believe he brought this out just to kick the habit.
Yeah, you reckon? even though I'm sure between takes he was doing that.
He's back there in the corner.
But it's basically a routine with a pen. Now, what I love about Greg's DVDs is he puts so much stuff on there. He's got like 8 different performances. All done to real people out
different
in the street.
Different angles and that
kind of thing. And what's quite funny is he's got one performance on there, and it says on there, this is where they almost caught me and I had to work really hard to get out of it.
Yeah.
And he's actually put that on there, so where they almost caught him, and then he still actually managed to get out of it.
Because that happens to you a lot when you're working, doesn't it?
Me, personally.
So you found that quite interesting.
Yeah, I found it quite interesting. What to do when you screw up. It comes with the gimmick. Now, what was nice, you've also got bonus routines on there. Garrett Thomas is on there.
Really?
Garrett's on there. Carl Andrews is on there. He was on a cruise at the time, and he shot it on his iPhone in his cabin of his in the cruise. David Grimpenwald, he's on there. And also another guy, Christian Greaser, who actually had the original concept for Pointless.
Oh, right, okay.
He's on there doing his original routine.
Now, we were asked to review this by... it was a Facebook request.
Yeah.
And we had a couple in a very short space of time sort of say, can you review Pointless? So I don't know if Greg's been out there sort of talking about this or whatever, because it is a slightly older item.
It's about a year old, and to be honest, I never really gave it much thought when it came out, which is surprising, because I normally...
I like Greg's recap routine and, in the ear and that kind of thing. I think that's a great routine.
Well, the beautiful thing about this is you can do this routine, and then you can go straight into recap. Or Sharp off my Chop DVD, you can go straight into that. So you can have like an absolutely massive, really long routine with a pen that opens up with this. And it's such a visual routine. In fact, I opened it up half an hour ago, and you know what, Dave?
You can do it already?
I can do it already.
You can do it already.
John, it's that time. Can you get off the sticks for me, my friend? Okay, so I'm going to do this as if John's the audience. I'm going to do this
John,
okay, because he's a better angle.
So you want me to lie then?
Yeah, lie. If you see something, just pretend it looks really good.
Okay.
Okay, so John, I'm going to hypnotise you. Okay, I'm going to hypnotise you. Let's see if I can actually hypnotise you. Yeah, John's looking all weird. John, which way is the pen pointing?
Up.
Very good. Now, which way is it pointing?
Down.
Very good. That's good. Now I pull out a math core. You see, if I go back and forth like this, the pen becomes pointless. Actually, I say it becomes pointless.
You're giving some reaction, John.
Yeah, John, I'm looking for a reaction.
Pretend you're
right
like
now.
Those birds on the video.
I'm trying to keep you shot because you're going up and
down. Right, okay. Don't go up and down.
I've got to do the moves.
As long as you don't expose the... It doesn't matter exposing it, as long as it stays in shot.
The point goes over there.
Yeah.
I'm going to do it again for you, John, because the first time maybe you didn't see what was going to happen. John, which way is the point pointing? I'll give you a clue.
Right.
As in?
My right.
Your right.
Your left.
You're not getting this, are you, John? Am I going a little bit too...
I like that. Making it feel stupid.
Yeah, that's what... make the audience feel stupid.
Greg doesn't do that. Greg does it in a really nice way. He scratches his ear and that sort of thing.
Here's a quote off me. Do the trick. Do it well. Do it bad. Do whatever. But always make the spectator feel like a prat.
You should start philosophizing.
Yeah, I really
Get
should.
Get a really good book.
He's quite good.
Like that bloke at International. Talk about your theories on magic.
Look, if I don't start... presenting this properly, we're going to have him ring up and start talking about, I'm not giving you this effect justice. You know, come that's on. Happened before.
Yeah. Not with Greg Wilson. Though.
Right.
Just everybody else.
Just everyone else. I'm going to show you the move. Okay? It's all to do with misdirection. That means making you look somewhere else. You see, what I do is I wait for you to look away for a split second. And when you look away for a split second, what I do is I just turn the pen round. Now, in slow motion, it looks like that. In full speed, it looks like that. Isn't that amazing? It's fantastic.
Yeah, it's good.
Now, I'm going to do it really slowly. I'm going to slow it down. Just put the cap on. I'm going to slow it down. Watch. One. Two.
That looks good.
Three.
That's good.
Now, you're going to have to get involved with this, Dave, because I'm going to go for the big finish, and John's got his hands on the camera. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to take the lid off. I want you to hold on to the nib, but I don't want you to get ink on your finger. Hang on, let me just put the thing on. Hold on to the right there.
Yeah.
Now, it's obviously pointing upwards.
Yeah.
If I just snap,
yeah,
that's the very second that it points downwards. And you can take off the cap, and you can examine everything. It's now instantly examinable, and all I have to do is take the pen back and put it in my pocket, and I'm reset, ready to go again.
That's great. You know what I like about it?
What?
One of the things, everything's here.
It's all up in the air.
Yeah, so you could do it at a table, trade show.
Mm.
You know, you can talk about the point.
Yep.
The point of this product is this.
Mm, that's,
you know,
nice.
The point I'm trying to get across here is this.
Yeah.
That kind of thing. I think for a trade show angle, you just started doing that there, and all I could think was trade shows. Point, the point of this, the point I'm trying to get across. You're not following the point here. The point is this.
I never thought of that, but that's very true. You could.
That's good.
Yeah,
that's good.
Look at his little face light up. Now he's gonna.
I like that.
The other thing is
that getting worker of the week.
It's definitely getting worker of the week. There's variations on there.
We're gonna have a worker of the week board next week, aren't
we,
John?
Yes, we are.
Yes,
we are.
Well, we get some incarnation of worker of the week's behind us or something.
Yeah. Yeah.
We're going to get the sort of graphic designers in to do something around the
really?
Back.
I thought we'd just get Matthew up with a couple of pieces of blue tack. And
that's probably going to be more the case.
Yeah.
How much are you going to give it?
Right, well, there's variations on there as well, just so you know. There's lots of variations, and he talks about how you can do it as one phase and do it as multi-phase. It's a really strong routine. One thing I like about it, you always talk about how it's important that when there's something, you're performing to an audience and there's something not happening, you fill it with magic.
Yeah.
So like you're getting someone to pick a card, and you always talk about having, this is something, while you're picking that card, let me just show you something with a pen. And it's something that can fill those moments.
Yeah.
Just like you. So I love it. I think any time non-card magic comes out that's as visual as that, I get excited. And this is going in my act. I did recap. I'm going to do this. I love it. I'm going to give this 96%. And obviously, worker of the week.
Yeah, I'll get one of them in for me, John. 95%. So it's not escaped my attention. We've only got three products here. We've got Cameron's DVD coming up soon. But you said we're doing that one at the end. We're doing something else now.
Yes, we are. It's going to be in my...
It's off the sticks, is it?
Yeah, it is. It's off the sticks. You're going to come into my office?
Right?
Yeah? Okay. I've got an office.
We were only joking about this the other day.
No.
But whenever you come in, you sit in other people's chairs.
Yes.
Because when Greg's not here, this is where I sit. This is my office, where I work.
Yeah, well,
and even Matthew's started telling you get out of his chair.
Yeah, yes, he has, but I've taken all
Greg,
that on board.
Greg, can you move? This is my office.
Well, now I've set up my own office. It's just out there. Seriously.
Right.
And I thought we'd do the next review in my office.
Okay.
Seriously, come on, Blammo. Come on, Dave. We're going to go into my office.
Right, okay.
Come on, Blammo.
Right, so this is
my office.
This is the office, is it? Right,
yeah,
okay.
This is the office. The office just outside World Magic Shop. The air conditioning's brilliant. And we're going to look at our next review. So right here, we're going to be looking at Paul Romani's briefcase illusion. Have you heard of this before?
I've never seen the briefcase illusion.
You know Paul Romani does the Charlie Chaplin act?
Yes.
Yeah? He uses this to open his Charlie Chaplin act. And the idea is that he has a table on the stage. There's a briefcase on the table. The spotlights come down and he climbs out the briefcase to start the show.
Right, okay.
Or you can have somebody in the middle of your show come on with a briefcase, put the briefcase down, somebody could get out. You don't have to use a briefcase, you can use a gift box, and it comes with a booklet, and what you've got in the booklet is you've got plans to actually build the illusion, and it's an illusion.
Can you follow these plans though?
Oh, it's really easy.
You don't need somebody like Bill Smith to make it for you?
No, this is a Bill Smith level. In fact, come on, I don't really know that much about illusions, and I built it absolutely fine.
Right, okay, yeah. From the plans.
From the plans, perfect. Because what you also get with it is you get video. You get links through to a video that goes through how to actually build it and how to take it apart. Hello, Blemmer. And how to do all that sort of stuff. And you've also got links to performances and live performances.
So how long did it take you to build the illusion?
2 days.
2 days?
Including finishing off the desk.
Right,
because it's
okay.
Stained.
Oh, you stained it?
Yeah, stained it as well. So,
and does it pack flat for transportation?
Completely.
Or
it's all
like
hinge
that?
Pins. It's all hinge pins. Yep. It takes like about, when you get to a gig, it takes 2 minutes, 3 minutes to put it all together and put the hinge pins in place.
That's not bad.
And take it away. Take
two,
it.
3 minutes to put an illusion together, John.
Yeah.
And learn a thing or two about that.
And taking it away, packing it away, just take out the hinge pins. It folds flat into four separate sections.
Cool.
And yeah, and that's the briefcase on top there. And it's just really good. I mean, it looks like it's meant to. It looks like a desk.
So what's the actual trick then?
Well, I opened it up half an hour ago. I can do it already.
You can do it already?
Yeah, I mean, the idea is you produce something or someone from
right.
a desk.
Okay. But
I'd have to do an illusion move.
You can do an illusion move.
I can do an illusion move. Watch this.
Watch this. Like, so is that your illusion move?
That's my illusion move. What do you reckon?
It's not bad. It's not bad at all. And then what happens?
Well, let me see. Here we go. Hang on. On three.
I think you're building this up way too much, can I say?
One, two, three. Shazam. There you go. Look at that. Mark Lavelle.
There he goes. Mark that works in our office. There we go.
There it is.
Mark, you promised us you were going to wear a bikini.
I do apologise.
But Mark's not a little guy.
Mark is not a little guy, actually. That's worth saying.
Yeah, because I was worried because the plans actually said, I read the plans, I built the whole thing, and then the plans actually said, this is built for my size. And so I was a little bit worried, but, you know, Mark fits in there. I've tried it with a couple of other people. They fit in fine, so it's not an issue at all.
Right, okay.
No, I mean, you're the illusionist, but, you know, for something that packs flat, takes 2 minutes to set up, 2 minutes
good.
To take
it's
away.
A good visual gag. If
yeah.
You've got a place to use it.
Yeah.
Like just having a desk on stage. If it was part of a set for a show, I think it makes sense.
Yeah.
Like, you know, the character Paul's created.
Yeah, it fits perfectly in the Charlie Chaplin. I like it. I really do. And the plan's full colour, really easy to follow. The video...
it's got to be easy to follow.
Well,
proof's
exactly.
In the pudding, we actually did... In fact, this is a new feature, I reckon. Craig builds stuff.
I like it. If you've got some stuff that needs building...
You're going to build it?
Yeah,
I'm
going to build it.
They've got those flat pack illusions. There's a book out the back there.
JC Sum.
I reckon we should...
Yeah, JC Sum.
Should we pick one out of there, John?
Yeah, pick one out and I'll build it and I'll have it ready. Definitely.
You'll have it ready.
Yeah.
Right, okay, we'll see. How much are you going to give it?
I'm going to give this 90%. I think, you know, if you've got a small show, like a kid's show or a small cabaret show, it could be enhanced by, you know, creating an illusion. It doesn't cost much to build. Once it's built, you know, it packs flat.
And you've got your own office as well.
And I've now got my own office here in the World Magic Shop car park. So,
right.
Win-win.
Right, okay.
90%, I say.
Absolutely fantastic. Well, we'll see you later then, Craig.
See you later.
Okay, take some calls for us.
In 1933, L. Baker created an effect called the deck that cuts itself, also known as the haunted deck. 3 years ago, I had an idea in my mind, a solution for the haunted deck, and I knew if this was going to work, it would change everything about the haunted deck dramatically. The spectator is the very last person who touches the deck before the haunting begins. Get this. No loop or thread work. There's nothing going from your body to the deck of cards. It's completely self-contained. And the deck being fully examinable before and after the effect. You can even place a clear bowl over the deck of cards to seal it off from any outside influences. You can even adapt the haunted system to your business cards. Haunted is always ready to go. You can do it surrounded. And for the final kicker, the signed card mysteriously jumps out of a deck of cards. My name is Peter Egging, and welcome to Haunted.
Right in the continued quest for Cameron Francis to bring out a product with every major magic producer on the planet, we have something else, the Corner and Exposure product.
By Paper Crane. You know, I think Paper Crane doesn't like us. We are the only production company.
We're the only ones.
That he hasn't done anything with. What's that? Big Blind Media, everybody, not us. Like every single producer, even Aldo Colombini, he's released something through.
You need to release something with us. Just release anything, you know.
Any old stuff, we don't care.
Yeah, your work on how to take the cellophane wrapper off a deck of cards or something like that. That'd be brilliant.
Anything like that will work. The real work on
just
that.
Just so we can say we've had a big part of this as well. Part of the legacy. So what did you reckon?
Well, I think the first reason is...
Synopsisize the first thing.
Okay, corner is, as it says...
An impossible transposition. A card is selected, signed, lost in the deck. The Joker is folded into quarters and stapled shut. The spectators can clearly see that it is indeed the Joker, which is folded and stapled, and then basically it changes in the spectators.
Yeah, now what they mean by they can clearly see is he folds the Joker so it's off-centre. So you can always see...
A bit like a magic...
A little bit like imagine. So you can actually see that it really is a Joker. It is then stapled, put in their hand, and then a previously signed card
disappears from the deck
or whatever.
It's replaced by the Joker face down.
Exactly. So when the open their hand and they see the folded up card, now they can instantly see
and it's stapled.
It's their selection and it's still stapled, and they pull the staple out and open it, and it's now their signed card. The construction of the routine is very nice. The gimmick is very clever.
I thought this was great. I think this is one of the things you completely miss the point, because you're a magician. You don't think like a punter. And this is something that I've got the ability to do sometimes. I know what you're going to say. And I think you completely miss the point sometimes, how punters actually think. And all the layers of impossibility is there. And I think this is very, very good. And I like the fact that when you fold up the card... which I actually missed the first time I saw the performance, Cameron, actually. And then when I looked back at it, I realised how good it actually was. The fact that you can display that folded card, they see 100% that's the Joker, as the staple goes in and you hand it to them.
Yeah.
And then it changes.
Yeah, it is clever. My attitude to this is you could achieve virtually the same effect with just a simple DL and folding up the card and stapling it in their hand.
No, you can't, because they are convinced. Even the girl on the DVD says, that was definitely
the Joker.
So
you're saying, we spoke yesterday, and you said doing a DL...
Yeah.
And then showing the cards changed
in
is
the
one of the most
hands.
Magical things that you can do.
Yeah.
So you're saying that when you do that normally, they don't think it's really the card?
No, they do. They do think it's the card.
So if they think it's the card, why bother
using it? You can think it's the card even
it?
More. So it's a valid technique and worth putting on a DVD.
But do you really
it's even
need
more
to,
impossible.
Do we really need to overconvince the layman? I mean, come on, they're laymen. They're stupid. Do we really need to overconvince them? You know... It's fine, you know, you just fold up a card, you put it in their hand. Yes, this allows you to display the fact that it's a Joker right
it
up
is
until
the
last second.
It's the finale to a routine. It's the finale. It's not just a moment of magic in a card routine. I know what you're talking about yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
That's a progression of moves and you're about to do something else afterwards.
Yep.
And it's stuff that goes on and on. This is a finale to a routine and it is impossible. It gets great reactions. I like that more than Exposure, which
although
you really liked.
I liked Exposure more than Corner. I thought that Exposure was excellent. Exposure, I love the premise of it. He does a trick, just a simple, tells them what the card is, and then he exposes it and tells them
how it's
done.
I quite like that part of it.
Yeah, I love the fact that he then tells them how it's done, and they go, and there's a hole cut in his card box, which is the pseudo-explanation for how he's done the trick. Now, what he then goes on to do is lose the card into the deck very cleanly. He never touches the deck. He shows the card case is empty. And in one magical visual moment, the card case is now filled up with the selected signed card. They can see into the card case.
One,
there's nowhere for it to go.
One magical... Magical... Really?
Really, yeah.
Okay, it's okay.
No, I thought that was really good. It
reminded me a lot of his...
Sudden Impact.
Yeah, the other, you know, where the card's sticking out the top and you click and it changes, which I liked a little bit more.
No, I think I preferred this.
I do like the fact that it completely cleans up afterwards and you can just give them everything straight away, which I think is quite good.
Completely clean at the end. Well, with both the routines. And although both routines have a paper crane moment, which is why I think Cameron actually did it with paper crane.
Yeah, I think probably that's what it was.
Both of them have a paper crane moment. It's nothing that difficult. It'll take you about 2 or 3 minutes to make up the gimmicks for both routines. Once they're made up, you can virtually instantly reset them and you're left with a regular deck with both routines. You can do both routines one after another if you wanted to. It seems to me that it's becoming the norm that, you know, we always used to talk about single trick DVDs.
Yeah.
It's now becoming two trick DVDs, isn't it? A lot of people
like
have
that
done
one
it.
Sweet and birthday card last
birthday
week.
Birthday card, and then you had Eric Ross who bought out three, but we all agreed it should have been two. So, you know, that counts as a two trick
DVD.
Yes,
that's a two trick DVD.
And this is another one, you know, and both tricks are great. You get a gimmick in there, not really a gimmick.
If you like the tricks, they're taught very well.
Yeah.
And you will not be surprised. There were, as with all Cameron's stuff, actually, you can tell he's gone out, you can tell he's worked it. Nothing's going to surprise you. No limitations in the real world.
Well, I've never hidden this. Cameron is one of my favourite magicians.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's not going to make me biased towards the mark. I think that Corner is okay. Not brilliant, but I think Exposure is fantastic. I think it's very, very good indeed.
I'm exactly the opposite. I think Corner's quite interesting as a technique. I like the fact you can clean up from it straight away afterwards as well. And that added convincer with the card folded up, it's like Andrew Gerrard, I was just trying to think of the name there, on the True Astonishment box set, he does card warp, but he uses a stapler. And for some reason, I've been out and worked that now. I did card warp for years. Yeah, it was okay. Started putting Andrew Gerrard's stapler touches onto it, and it just does something to punters.
I agree.
It does something to them, like it's even more impossible.
One of the strongest routines I do ever, and I have ever done, is Inside Outside by Gary Kurtz. And if you haven't seen Unexplainable Acts, the book, you want to get that. It's one of the best routines you will ever learn. Inside Outside by Gary Kurtz.
What's that? Is that like a card warp thing as well?
Well, it uses a stapler. It doesn't really matter. Get into this another time. But he uses a stapler. And it just makes the effect way more impossible. I agree with what
just
you're saying.
Just because it's stapled.
Yeah, stapling a playing card for some reason increases the impossibility. But I think that you could do exactly what Cameron's done with Corner and staple the card without needing that convincer. The gimmick that achieves the convincer is nice, and you know, you're left clean, but I don't think it's needed. Whilst with Exposure, the gimmick that's used to achieve that, you couldn't do that with a regular deck.
And it is an interesting prop. With the corner cut out of the card case. It is an interesting prop. I liked it. I liked the corner thing. I thought the Exposure thing was okay. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to give it 88%.
I'm going to give it 89%. Again, another really good release by Cameron. And Paper Crane is still hitting them out of the park.
As usual. Probably the producer of the year, actually. They've done some good stuff this year.
Have we heard back from Amanda yet about coming and working for
us? No, she's not replied yet.
Not even said anything?
No, we need to get her a desk.
I'll get you a desk right next to mine, Amanda. won't need a fan in the summer.
We'll see you next week on the Wizard Product Review. Follow us in all the usual places. Facebook,
YouTube,
Magic Cafe,
the Office of Advisements, which is the Magic Cafe, which can take people now Google the Office of Advisements. That's our bit.
See you next week. I'm Dave.
I'm Craig.
Hey guys, this is Peter Egging, and I would just like to take the opportunity to say that I am really excited that the World Magic Store is having an exclusive on my upcoming release, Haunted. So if you want to ensure your copy, order right now from worldmagicstore.com. Oh, and Dave and Greg, check out my backyard on this DVD.